know Amanda Freed talked about this. I couldn't agree with her more. Like, get them in shape, get them ready to go. We're going to understand the game plan. Fastball's a priority. And then just to kind of zoom in on this, just to break down the drills, why the need. The basic idea to me is if you don't have strong mechanics, you're going to break down somewhere, whether it's with fastball or a curveball or whatever it is. You might get away with it from 12 to 14, and at 14 to 16, all of a sudden, you're not going to do that. I have a cousin right now. She's 9 years old. I love her to death. She's all legs and limbs, but she does this. She pitches really bad, really, really bad. And my biggest concern with her, and talking to her mom, who's also a pitcher, is that she's never going to get out of that if we don't break it down. She's 9. This is a very, very important time of year, time of her life to really break those bad habits. So I'm really big into that. I'm all about lunging. Pitchers hate lunging. They hate running. Really, they hate anything but pitching. I'm all about lunging and running and all the things that they hate, because those are what transfer into the energy and the power that comes from pitching. I'm all about the front side push. When I talk about that, I'm talking about that front leg. I'm a righty. So for me, it's this side. Pushing and reaching, arm speed, having a firm front leg when you land, posture, so having the shoulders up, and then obviously being deceptive goes with all the drills. So as we get going, I'll talk about that a little bit more. But like I said, I wanted to really dive into the drills right away. So these are a few drills that we use for just fastballs. So we would only throw fastballs with these. We would never throw like a changeup or anything out of them. A lot of them have different names. So if I learn a drill from someone, I name the drill after them. So Houston drill, learn it from a Houston coach. USA drill, learn it from South Alabama coach. Things like that. I'm not going to take credit where I didn't come up with it. I also don't name them after me either if they're mine. So the Houston drill is something we talk about a lot, and I'll show you the video and then I'll talk through it. Lunge drill variations, we do these all the time. You guys all know what long toss is, I assume. I'm not gonna like show you a video of that. I think you guys all get it. My biggest thing with long toss, and the same as Amanda Freed last night, if you guys win, is that I do think we need to walk through it or get a kind of a, not a running start, I'm not a big running start person, but I don't think we need to stand still to long toss. I think it should be okay, I'm walking into it and I'm gonna create a little bit of that power to go through. Harness drills, so that goes kind of without saying. You can buy like little rubber bands, you can have an actual harness, doesn't matter to me. I think pulling from behind is really awesome. Also pulling from the front view. So like if I'm pitching and you're pulling me, I'm having to feel what it's like to be pulled and still resist. If you're pulling from behind me, I'm having to pull you with me instead. So you can do both sides. You can do this with a lot of different things. Like I have used like ropes, I've used like the things you buy at like Academy Sports that are just little rubber bands. I've broken lots of bands, I've also popped people in the back accidentally, like shit happens. But you can do a lot of different things. But feeling the weight transfer on both sides is actually a really good thing to do. So a lot of people are always behind. You can do it from the front as well. Split jump, I'm gonna show you a power drive. Power drive is just, do you guys remember that? Like the little, it's like a little circular thing. Amanda Scarborough kind of patented it, and it clicks down. It's a lot like what they were selling over there. It kind of clips you down and you create a ramp to then push off of. So we use that a lot if someone struggles in that aspect. All right, so for the first couple of videos, and I don't know if they're gonna play, let's see. Cool, you can see it all. All right, so this first drill, this is just something, well, that's cool, you can't really see her. But this is lunge drill. So basically, we're talking about lunge drill. I'm not gonna pitch it so you guys can see. Is we have a bunch of variations. We have a variation where you are completely still, so you get to a good 90-90. I'm very much a stickler on like the mechanics and body position. There's a lot of times you'll see girls that are not in good position. So you want this to be nice and stacked. You're just gonna tuck that back toe, come up off. So you're maybe, you know, 5-ish inches off. You're in a good position here. However you wanna start, you can start. And you're just pitching out of this position. And what you want it to look like is two things. One, you're not doing this. This is number one. Our butt goes out, we tip over, we try to like push ourselves up a different way. What we wanna create in our throw one is that since you're pushing out of this position, clean as possible. I'm gonna go like past my back. Okay, so we're just trying to create that forward movement out of the pitch and getting into the legs. All right, so So that's one lunge drill. There's a bunch of variations. I think I show a couple, but since the videos are slow, the other version would be to step into it and pitch out. Last one, which is a favorite, you really want to punish them, is you pitch into it, pitch out of it, come through, and lunge twice. A little conditioning. I'm out of breath. I'm not even doing anything. All right, so this is the second one I just showed. These are super old, by the way. This is like 4 years ago. So she obviously really likes it, as you can tell. So this is something that is a really good way to feel what you're trying to teach. Like, you want them to be powerful, you want them to be explosive. They need to feel it. They need to know what that feels like. So in doing this, you're like, there's no tape in here. Holy shit, like my legs are on fire. Like, you're having to feel what it feels like to really pop the hips out, okay? Show this drill before we go. Alright, this is Houston drill. I'm gonna show it again. I don't know why the button keeps going. Let me try full screen. There we go. Okay. So our chest is up. So the whole idea of this, and I like this because it teaches you feel, the whole idea is you're in this position, you're gonna lean a little bit over, but your chest is still up. So I'm not this, my back isn't rounded. Okay, so my foot's here, my chest is up. I'm just picking up a little bit and I'm pushing from here. So what I'm trying to create is drawing that straight angle out. So you should be able to do this without being outside of your body. So we're trying to create that balance, we're trying to get them to feel that power. So this is all about this front side. It's really not really talking about or thinking about anything. That being said, this isn't about accuracy. You're not trying to throw to a catcher and throw strikes and like do any of that. I don't care where the ball goes in these drills because I'm trying to develop a feel. So it starts with just that piece on the mound. Later in life, we're gonna talk about the accuracy. So, Houston drill. Oh my God, what's happening? Jump. These couldn't be worse. Just letting you know if anybody wants to get up and demo. So the only idea here, and this you have to be very, very mindful of, because what happens as females, typically, our knees want to do this. I'm not any less guilty than anyone else. So when you see females jumping, you have to make sure that they can do this. So I can like barely do it, right? So you might want to start with just split jumps. Then add in the pitch. We also have a variation where you start with your opposite foot forward, and you just do it once, so you can feel it. Because maybe that too is a little bit like, you know, maybe a 12-year-old has no balance. We have 18-year-olds with no balance, so it's no different. The biggest thing, how many of you guys know, like, anything about Olympic lifting? Like, Olympic lifting, is that in your sport at all? What I mean is like power clean, squats, deadlift, anything? So when we talk about like power cleaning, don't grade me on my form. So when we talk about power cleans, like the biggest idea is that you're gonna throw your hips, you're pulling the weight. So starting here, you're pulling the weight up, popping your hips, and then you're gonna catch, right? And that's the whole idea. Your form, maybe not great, okay? When we talk about pitching, I equate it to that a lot. Okay, so we can go with power cleaning, we can Google this, like Olympic lifting, whatever. When you pitch, think about what you're doing. So like, I'm gonna stride off the mound, this is my mound. What am I trying to do? I'm trying to transfer weight and then push or throw the hips forward to create that movement and that like force, okay? So when you do drills like this, this is what we're doing. We're trying to build, what does that feel like? The only difference is you're doing it off of one leg, essentially. You're starting with both. You do get a little bit of it from both, but really, it's that single leg movement. So when we do drills like this, you're isolating specific pieces of it. This doesn't mean this is exactly how you pitch. This is isolating this front side to get it to really push you forward. These can be used in so many ways. Like, you can do this 10 times, 10 split jumps, and they're gonna be like, okay, you can do that and then have a pitch. Okay, your little teeth, good. You can have a pitch, every 10. You can have it as an endurance thing. You can do this in your drills. You can spread them out. Like, you can superset them. Like, you can do one lunge drill, one Houston, one split jump, and then rotate through that. You can do so many different things. The biggest thing to me when you're teaching pitchers, you're creating flow, right? We're trying to get them to explosive, and this is a good way to do it. So these are like my main, these are like my mainstays, my absolutes. We do these all the time. Does anyone have questions on any of these before I move on? So I apologize. I didn't have anyone to demo. So again, these are with fastball. So just going through a little bit of what we do. Bucket drill, I'm sure you guys have all seen that. I think I have a demo on here. BOSU ball, does anyone know what that is? It's like a half physio ball and the other side's flat. You can use both sides. It's actually really awesome. So like Amanda said, using the core and the stability of pitching. Weighted balls, you guys know what those are. 60-foot pitch. The only thing I will say about that, that I really love, I use a lot for change-up. So when we're throwing change-ups, we might start, and we're like, wow, this is just really not super deceptive, and maybe she's slowing down, or she's trying to like make it do something it's not doing on its own. I will have them throw at 43 feet, and then I'll back them up. So it's probably closer to, I would say like 50 to start. So we're gonna pitch from 50, full go, like off the mound. I'm doing my full motion. I'm just trying to get them to overfill, over-exaggerate that change. I might back them up a little bit more. So if you watch, like, do Lacey Waldrop, she played at FSU. Amazing drop ball, amazing change-up. She does this all the time. Like, this is something that just helps you feel like, okay, I'm going to over-exaggerate. Then when I get back at that 43 feet, okay, I can throw it from here because now it seems easy. So we like to train, like, long distance to then bring them back in. The other thing is plank. I'm sure you guys have done this where you have like a board like that and you're just trying to keep them in a straight line. It's the same as a power line. I'm not going to go too much into that. You guys probably do that already. I'm going to show you the pole and the power drive just so you guys can kind of see. This is a power drive drill we like to do. You just hop up on it, single leg, and pitch out of it. So she's hopping up, clicking down, pitching out of it. A, single leg hops are terribly hard. It keeps you balanced, it keeps you on that front foot. You feel the click, so as soon as that clicks down, you're using that ramp to then push you forward, which is something we talk about a ton. Now, excuse me, because these are me, just ignore my face. I'm like really proud of myself, because the first one was pretty good. All right, so you're holding a PVC pipe. Guy just before this had a bunch of them. The only goal is that you're just holding it, you're standing wherever you would stand. I'm starting the ball over and I'm just working on this motion. So all I'm trying to create is that straight line. How many of you guys have the swimmers that are like, woohoo! Like they pitch like that. This is a really good drill for them. I have one now. We do this so much, it's ridiculous. She's like, pull. I'm like, yes. Because it's just helpful to throw against this front side. So talk about front side all the time. This is the reason, and this is a very baby drill, if you will, but it's timeless because they all do it. We all get those bad habits sometimes. Okay, so the next drill is okay. So you're probably like, okay, that's a warm-up drill. You're right, but also you're not, because what I'm trying to do is sequence. Okay, so what happens a lot of times with pitchers is we get and our gloves going, but our arms over here, and then we're leaning and we're pushing. So when we warm up, we try to work down the power line in a state of like, I would say the arm circle is about 60% the release from here down to here. So I'm old, so don't judge them. Don't look at the skill level, just look at the intent. Okay, so I'm here, I'm nice, easy, nice, easy, boom. I get my hand down, I go. Here, I'm nice, easy, boom. So all I'm working on is this reach, which is easier said than done, and then creating the whip. So it looks like just a regular old drill, but really I'm trying to work on creating that connection. So do you guys remember the old school jump ropes that were made with those plastic things that were like stacked together? Think of your arm like one of those. Like you want it to be all bent, 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 and then it's boom, you put it together and it creates that whip. Like nice and smooth, like all those pieces just click into place. So it seems really small, but this is the most important part of pitching. And if you're going to do drills and you're not doing this part, then you shouldn't be doing the drills. And that starts with the leg drills. I show them first because everyone loves leg drills, but this is the stuff that really, really matters. of some of the little bit harder. So this is called a Bose ball for you guys who don't know. So my face is doing that because this is so hard. Like, you're having to balance with your feet up. So I know it's a quick video, but my feet are up. See how I'm kind of bouncing? We have girls that can do this and they might as well be pitching on the ground. Like, they're like, they catch the ball, their feet stay up the whole time. Just throwing on the ground, you can start like this, trying to do it from here, and then adding in the ball. This is a super hard drill because you're trying to stack your core. And like Amanda said, I'm stealing a lot of her stuff, but it's all, it's everything. It's the trunk, it's the butt, it's the hips, it's the thighs, it's all of this. So core is not just like the crunches, like she said, it's like, can you get on a ball, hold on, and still be accurate? Like, it's not about the accuracy part, but it's about being able to stack and be in that straight line. Carly Hoover is like one of the best, hardest throwing pitchers that LSU's ever had. And she literally can do this with a weighted vest on a real ball. Not a Bosu ball where it's flat on the side. A real physio ball. Okay, so like, this can't be better. Let's see, I think we got one more video. Alright, so this is bucket drill. This is really old school. This is for someone who doesn't understand the up and a lot of you guys, I know you have pictures that are like, you know what I'm talking about? Like, their legs don't bend. You're like, what is happening? This is a really good draw. It's very basic. You put a bucket up, you make them like kind of feel it out, see where it needs to be. You don't want to be too close, you don't want to be too far away. I actually land kind of awkwardly because I'm just an awkward person. But when you pitch, you're just trying to feel that extension. So it's not about the finish. You're just, oh, okay, that's what it feels like to me. Up, out. Okay, so that's a really basic drill. We do this a lot for people who maybe just tend to kind of just step off. That's like kind of how we were taught a long time ago, is just you step off and you hope for the best. With that, I would like to say I'm not a believer in overstriding. A lot of pitching coaches, like, you get in and they're like, all right, you need to stride really far. How many of you have seen someone be like, okay, now you're going to lay on the ground, and however long you are, you're going to jump there. You guys probably don't. I know I have. I don't believe in that. If you overstride, you're losing power, you're not staying stacked, everything's gonna get out of alignment, it's just not good for you. Like, I am 5'7", and I'm trying to let go of a pitch over here, like, how good's it gonna be? I'm either gonna be back here, I'm gonna be over here, or I'm doing something that's really not natural for my body. And we wanna make it as comfortable as possible. That's not to say we don't push on. You all have the pitchers that do this. We want power, but we don't want overstriding. And I think there's a fine line. I think you need to pay attention to what you're saying and how you're saying it and what they're doing, because we don't want pitchers that are trying to throw hard so much so, because when you're doing that here, that happens up here. Right? You guys all have those pitchers. And that's just not how it works. Like, it's all about fluidity and being able to like get your arm in a circle and have it connect. So as much as I love these drills, make sure the language is still but within me. It's like, I'm not Monica Abbott. She's gonna overstride so much further than me, but she's gonna stride where her body takes her, not even further. She goes outside of the circle. I'm not seeing the outside of the circle. Okay, so any questions on fastball drills? I'll do questions at the end too. So I love change up, you guys. If you've been in my talks, you know this now. Double circle is my favorite drill. Over the string is exactly as it sounds. You can put it up however you want. Chairs, bench, whatever. It's just putting up a string of some sort that you're throwing over for the changeup. There's nothing better visually to see, like, okay, this ball, not only is it slow, but it's moving down. Or not only is it slow, but it's moving down. I think it's hard to go slow and move in. Because you're going all the time. Slow enough, not a good place to be. But to me, it's like, if I'm throwing a changeup, I want it to do two things. It's got to change speeds, and it's got to do something else. Because changing speeds is cool, but if it's just flat, it's gonna get hit hard, really hard. And it's gonna look like a knuckleball as it goes out of the field. So over the string drill is huge for a pitcher just to see. And if you do a drill, so you can do it off the mound. However you throw a changeup, it doesn't matter. It's just a good visual to see what that looks like. Building off of that, with little kids, my favorite drill to do, and even with my college girls love this drill, when we go back to play, like, yes. Okay, it's put a bucket out. It doesn't have to be a big one, it can be whatever. Put it on the outside, the inside, put it little, put it in the middle of the plate. You're just trying to put your change up in the bucket, which is such a good visual because you're thinking, okay, the mouth of the bucket, you know, is here. I'm trying to push that pitch into it. So I talk about pushing one changeup just because to me that makes more sense. You want to be fast, but you want to push the ball down through the zone. So whether you're letting it go here, you're flipping it out of the back, whatever you want to do, change up, there's a million ways to do it. You're trying to put it into that bucket. And I think that's really helpful for the young kids who maybe don't understand. A lot of young kids get here and they just like stop, or they think they have to take their arm out and around, or you know, you guys see it all. So those are things I really like. And I already talked about long toss change. Start them at 43, back them up to 50, back them up a little further. Sometimes, you know, going super far is not beneficial. I would never go past like 60 feet. But depending on arm strength, this is also something we're able to do with fastball. So like throw fastball max effort, that's kind of your conditioning. Okay, now throw your change up. Go back to back and see what that looks like. See if you can tell it's coming, things like that. So this drill, this is double circle, just so you guys can kind of see it. It's me again. I'm excited. So I'm throwing change up here. I'm just trying to get my arm circle to look the same, let it go. That's it. I'm not using my legs here. I'm just isolating that arm circle. So all I'm trying to do is make sure that every time it goes around, it looks the same. You'd be really surprised at, I know I make it look so effortless, but this is actually really challenging. You'll see pitchers just chuck it up in the ceiling, they'll let it go too early, there's all kinds of things. I actually talked to, I'm not name dropping, I'm just telling you everybody does this. Michelle Gascoigne, she pitched at Oklahoma, she's at Northwestern, she loves this drill, she had an amazing changeup. This is what she does with her pitchers all the time. It's just a good way to work on that timing. Speeding up the arm, let it go, speed up the arm, let it go. Because that's what change is all about. So we do this a ton. If we're working on a mechanical day, we're always throwing change up almost every time we throw. So this is just a great way to kind of feel what that feels like. Questions on change up? Oh God. All right, so rise ball. I went in order of my favorite pitches. So if you want drop ball drills, I only have a few. Rise ball is one of the hardest pitches to teach, in my opinion, and to master. The biggest thing that we work on is understanding what the back hip does and understanding where your body needs to be. Do you guys have rise ball hits? Or is this like far of it? I'm gonna show you anyways, because we're not. The only thing I'll say about rise when you're teaching it is don't try to change body position to the point where it's not the same as a fastball. I think a lot of people get in this habit of rise ball. Oh, okay, rise ball, you have to get here, you have to dip down, and you have to get underneath it. And like, at this point, I mean, whoa, what are we doing? Like, this is such a bad position to be in. You're losing your power off the backside. I'm a big believer in no matter what you're teaching, it should look the exact same. So for me, when we talk about rides, we do a lot of drills backwards. So we're working on my catcher's here, I'm standing here, I'm still nice and neutral, and all I'm doing is spinning the ball backwards. Because that's all rises, we're just working on that movement. Under the string is exactly the same as over string. You set your rise ball string up high, you're trying to get that ball to go up and underneath it. Knee down, exactly as it sounds, you're just working on how can I get, so whatever you believe in. I know some people believe you step like this, some people are like this. I'm not getting into that today. However you believe in it, you're just working on that feeling of like, okay, I'm here and being under it. Your arm will naturally dip down to rise while you're trying to get underneath it. You don't have to start here. Your body will naturally take it. The last one I'm going to show you guys is back hip drill. The reason I like this is because it's an over-exaggeration, and I'm extremely extra as a human being, so I like to over-exaggerate everything to help you feel. So if you were throwing rise ball, you would probably be somewhere here, you let it go, you'd be like dipped back. I like to take this hip, get it out of the way, so I'm like staggered here, and I'm going to pitch here. What that's going to do is create an avenue for my arm to be inside my hip, which is what you're trying to do when you throw a rise ball or pretty much any pitch. Okay, so when I throw a rise ball, I should be here, my hand should be down, my pinky should be towards the arm, I should be coming in to the plane. is out of the way. I'm just feeling what it feels like. My arm, my back, shoulder is automatically dipping. And all I'm working on is just feeling what it feels like. So it's very simple. That's as far as I'm going into rise, because I think rise is like the one pitch that you really can't, you don't want to mess up. Drop, screw, and curve. So do you guys have these pitches in comparison to rise? I feel like drop, screw, and curve are usually ahead of rise at this age level. Is that fair? My biggest thing when you're teaching this is don't teach it too early. If you had a baseball, if you had a son and he played baseball and he was 10, would you start teaching him how to throw a slider? Probably not. We really protect little boys in the best way possible in baseball because we have it figured out a little bit more than I think it is. Unfortunately, pitching in softball, we have this idea that it's more natural and they can handle it, and I really just don't believe it. I don't think there's any reason why my girl needs to be throwing a screw, a rise, a drop curve, backdoor screw, and all these things. Like, we don't need that. We're teaching them these bad habits, and it's too much. When they master fastball change, maybe give them something else. Hopefully they're 12 to 14 when they start teaching, when they learn that. And I know that's hard for you. I know there's other kids. You got mini Monica Abbott and Jenny Finches running around that are 14 and they throw all these things. But I'm telling you, like, it is, you're doing a disservice because by the time they get to college, you're like, I have 8 pitches. And they have like 1. They have maybe 1. I mean, they're burnt out because they've been throwing screwballs since they're 5. Okay? So to me, when you start building this in, it's like they have shown that they have mastery over that fastball. Maybe change up is in the works. I get it. Change up changes as you grow. But when you start adding these in, really be mindful of that. Like, are they ready for this? Can they handle it? Start slow. So when we talk about curve or screw, it's kind of, to me, they're kind of like, they're like friendly neighbors, but they're not really quite the same. Like, one's going across, one's going down and in. Screwball is not something I would ever teach if you're below 15, just because why? Drop ball. You have 2 different ways. You go over the top or you can peel. Anyone who have any body feel under any of those? Yeah, dropper. Just drop.
Just the peel, but now it's the roll
over. Okay, roll over drop. Somebody else raise their hand? Yeah. Okay, cool. So, my biggest thing with drop that I look for is that we're not manipulating the shoulder so much that you're getting kind of like outside of your body. Like I talked about, so a lot of times you're really super, like, you know, and that's not a peel, that's a push. So to me, it's like you're feeling it's the exact same. The only difference is you're coming off the seat, you're letting go of the shoulder, right? So you're looking for good posture, you're looking for the strong front side. Drop, roll over is the exact same way. The only difference is you're doing this. What I see a lot with young ones and with my age group is this. You want to drop like this. You want to take it like out and around. If you take it forward, you want to go outside of your body. One, you lose power, right? Because then your force is going this way. You want to take it straight down the line. Drop ball to me, you're over the toe, you're pushing down. Straight line. This is a straight line. Curve ball is the same thing. I actually just demoed curve on here because I kind of assumed curve would be one of those pitches that we go to first. It's the exact same as rise. Like, a lot of times when we teach curve to stagger, like I just did with rise, and that you're going to throw against the strong side, I like to do the drill backwards. Get this open, get this out of the way, so that you can pull the legs all the way through. So curve, you're just pushing across, closing towards that front hip. So I'll show this real quick. Exact same as rise, only difference now you see my thumb a little bit more, you see my front hip is open, and I'm just working on creating that spin straight across. It's just giving me the clearance. So you can do this with anything. Like, you have a kid who keeps hitting their back hip. You guys all have those kids, right? That's like, and they get the bruise and it hurts and it's really painful. Alright, let's do some fastball drills with it out of the way. So I can feel what it feels like to be clear, even with a fastball, just because that's what we run into. We get people whose hips meet their hands, so they get stuck. We also have people whose hands meet their hips, and they're all over the place, right? So these are drills that you can apply to pretty much anything you're throwing. Again, though, my biggest thing when you start teaching curve, drop, screw, rise, is teaching them right mechanics first and start slow. You shouldn't be throwing it too hard. I know all these pitchers are like, oh yeah, I learned it yesterday. I'm like, oh, good. Oh my God, why? You know, because you're just setting them up to fail. No one learns that quickly. I don't care who you are. You're not that good. So lastly, like, so how because I don't think you can ever do them too much. I think there's days where they're not necessary. Like if you're about to play a game, then you don't need to be doing a million drills. But I think you can wear them out. You can do them a lot. You can build them in. We have a good setup where we do every day, so they know, all right, today we're doing rise stuff. You need to do your rise every day, which means whatever those drills are. So maybe for Becky, it is, you know, this rise drill where your hips out of the way. We do the backwards ones. We work underneath the pole, and we do the strength drill. We know that that's going to be part of it. Or, okay, we're doing fastball work, so we know we're going to do a leg series. Then we're going to transition into, again, the pole, and then whatever. Okay, so I like to make sure that this is a common language. Don't just do it once and forget about it. I do that. I used to do this all the time. Like, oh, we're going to do all these drills, and it's great. And we do it one day, and we never go back to it. What's the point? We just wasted our time. So you have to make sure it's built in, and it doesn't have to be by itself. It can be the beginning, the end, the middle. Oh, I thought he was going to get it. I thought he was going to get up that ramp. I'm sorry. You have to find the time to, like, put it in and make it a thing. This is terrible for me. I'm like, I can't not watch him try to get up that ramp. The memory patterns are super important. That's what you see in growth. That's what you see do it. All of you guys who do pitching lessons, how many of you have the pitcher who's like, yeah, I only pitch here. Yeah, like, this is my Monday lesson. I pitch here and then I do shit until I come back next Monday. That is why I hated lessons, number one. But two, that's not good for them. You gotta find a way. For you, it's fine, because you're getting paid, I assume. But I know everybody in this room is doing it for other reasons. So there has to be a way to get them to buy into it. It has to be more than once a week, and especially when they're learning. I mean, a 12-year-old pitching, you can't just pitch once a week. Nobody can. So to me, you see the most growth when you see them doing this at least once a week, and then pitching on top of it. So if I'm 12, maybe I throw three times a week. One of those days a week, I'm working on my drills. I'm working on how can I get more explosive. Get a little more spin on the ball, whatever it is. I didn't dive deep into spin, but I mean, you can wrap balls and tape, you can do all kinds of stuff just so they can see it. I'm all about the feel and seeing it themselves. If you're having to tell them everything, they're not actually there. So if you can find a way to say, hey, what do you see, what do you feel? Those are ways to empower them, to get them to teach themselves, because you don't get to pitch with them, not on the mat. We gotta find a way for them to kind of figure it out. I think this is my last slide, so I can open it up to, oh, I lied, here's my polar bear. This is something we talk about a lot. You're never too big to do the little things. I don't care if you're 12 or if you're 55, you still gotta do the little things. So kids will always complain about teamwork. They'll always complain about, you put them, you know, you go to your wrist snaps, and pitchers always hate that, but those are the fundamentals, and that's what builds the big picture. Jenny Finch, I guarantee you, she went warmed up. She would probably do some drills. Okay, so if they're doing it, everyone should be doing it. I actually have a funny story to share about Natasha Watley. Did you guys go to her talk? Okay, she's amazing. When I was in college, my pitching coach knew her. They played together. She FaceTimed us. This is when FaceTime would, like, just start with Skype. And Natasha Watley FaceTimes us. Remember, we think we're hot shit, right? Like, Jackson University, we're like, no, but we're trying not to be like totally nerdy and like blow it. So we're all like, oh, hey, Tosh, what's up? Anyway, she told us this story about kind of what she told us today, about how she you know, kind of took advantage of things and she had to kind of learn how to work. And I'll never forget her saying that she does extra after every practice. And I'm sitting here thinking, wow, this is the best softball player in the entire world. She does extra. And here we are. Always reference her because you're never too big for that. If you're the best player on the team or the worst, you're never too big to go do a couple extra reps and whatever it is. Maybe it's 10 leg drills, maybe it's 5 hits off the tee, it doesn't matter. Those are things I think that are so simple, they're so controllable, and if Natasha Wally's doing it, I'm doing it, right? So that's kind of what's stopping me. I went through that really fast, but I actually only have 5 minutes. But does anyone have questions about drills, want to see something, etc.?